In this figure, we want to do a comparison between skeletal and cardiac muscle, specifically looking at the separation in time of the stimulus from the response, the development of tension. Let's look up here at skeletal muscle first, and what we've done is we've graphed the action potentials below the development of tension that are caused by those action potentials. And if we look at those action potentials due to sodium influx causing depolarization, potassium efflux causing repolarization, those action potentials last about 2 to 5 milliseconds, very short-lived. And that action potential initiates the excitation-contraction coupling mechanisms to develop twitch tension. And what we find is that the twitch tension actually occurs after the action potential because it was so short-lived. And the tension development itself, the twitch duration, can be anything from about 10 to about 100 or even more milliseconds in duration. Now, what happens is if our action potentials are separated in time, we get individual twitches as shown here on the left. However, if we increase our action potential frequency, right, stimulate that same muscle fiber more frequently, then what we find is that because the action potentials are so short-lived, but the twitches are much more prolonged, the twitches will actually become additive, right? We initiate a new contraction before the last one has ended, and so they start to become additive, and we get something called wave summation. If we go to a very high frequency of stimulation, we get this very high action potential frequency, we will actually reach a very strong and prolonged contraction known as tetanus. Now, it's important to note that individual muscle contractions in skeletal muscle actually require wave summation and tetanus for prolonged development of tension. Remember, our individual twitches are 100th to 1/10th of a second in duration. There's very few things that we can do that are that fast, maybe blinking. Right? And so most skeletal muscle contraction requires wave summation or tetanus. If we come down here to cardiac muscle, all right, we've got our action potentials down here on the bottom. You'll note that they are much, much longer. This action potential is actually somewhere in the ballpark of 250 to 400 milliseconds in duration. So, and part of that action potential actually involves calcium influx. And so our tension development, our twitch, actually occurs during the action potential. Now, as you can see, is when the action potential ends, we start to recover and our tension starts to fall, right, bringing us back to baseline. What this means is that we are incapable of having additive twitches. Remember, a twitch in this case is actually the heartbeat, right? The coordination of many cells, but altogether they are generating the heartbeat, individual twitches of those cells. And again, because our refractory periods are so long, the twitches are separated in time. They cannot become additive. And so wave summation and tetanus is avoided. That's essential because tetanus, a prolonged contraction, would actually oppose the heart refilling with blood, which is absolutely essential prior to the next ejection phase. Additionally, our maximum rate of action potential frequency over here is limited such that our maximum heart rate is usually about 200 beats per minute or less. That's also critical because heart rates, anything above that, again, well above 3 beats per second, can limit venous filling and reduce cardiac output.